I don't believe a word of it. I'm straight when other people think I'm stoned sometimes. Oh, I stumble and giggle with tremendous conviction for all about, don't I? But I'm in there watching. Yeah, I think I was sloshed by all accounts. Oily smirks, quips and belches, eh? But it's such hard work watching. You watch. We're in a club not far from London's notorious Cannabis Street. The door opens, the head valet begins. Someone or something's coming in. I suck in my cheeks. Could it be a camera? And have a good butcher's to see if it's anyone important. And if it is, I look away quick. And other watchers think I'm important too. And if I strike it dead lucky, the important someone thinks I'm important and joins me for a drink. Hello, man. Nice one. Yeah, right together. Too much right on far out. Oh, yeah, Frank McGurk, George Work. That can last for about 5 minutes, and then we watch together. Yeah, right, nice one. Together, too much right out far on you. I wonder if I'll miss anyone important if I step out to the bog to check myself. If I go for long periods without a mirror, I forget who I am. Any case, I might bump into someone important in there and strike up a deep-voiced intimacy. Well, we all have to have a splash, whoever we are. And it's a great leveller. Highest up the ball for half a crown, rather. Oh, man, I'll show you mine if you're in the charts. Drugs? Oh, yes, and you should see what a cheery lot we are in the mornings.
Conventiero, that's Freaks and Watcher.
Three years have passed since Madge and Bobby Rawlinson pulled up roots and were arrested by the Parks Department. Jeremy Sphincter sailed for Australia after the poultry scare. Old Mr. Trelawney stays on at the farm a broken man, and now an incurable alcoholic. Apart from his weekly visit to the village shop for a couple of tins of ready rubbed, he hardly ventures out at all and devotes his remaining years to breeding the beautiful guppies for which he is so justly famous. Sandra smells. Randy has turned in on himself, no mean feat for a 30-stone man. After all, he is still married to Sharon and is only Paulette's father by the skin of his teeth. But Rosemary has her hands full at Rawlinson End, trying to bring up Timothy and Letitia, now at that awkward age when they start asking questions. If only Tom were here. Meanwhile, Aubrey and Maureen Rawlinson have gone to the old house, convinced they will find something to prove Roger's birthright. but unaware that Paul Maynard is hiding in the priest hole. Now read on. Somewhere inside my head, a bell sounded. The seconds jumped out of the ring and the minutes flew from the corners.
For God's sake!
Somebody shouted from the script in front of them.
For God's sake, throw in the kitchen sink!
There was a terrific splash and the sink lay upturned on the floor, gasping like a landed fish. In a flash, Aubrey was on his knees beside it. He tenderly took the limp tap in his hands, turning it slowly. Without taking his eyes off, he looked up at Maureen. Darling, he said thoughtfully. Do you remember that party? The buffet table was over there, wasn't it? I think that was the first time you ever kissed me. I shall never forget it. We looked so silly in those rabbit costumes, and yet somehow it didn't seem to matter at the time. We drank oodles of bubbly, and then I did an unpardonable thing. Everyone laughed at the time, but they never asked us back, did they? She turned from the window to stare at him. He looks so sinister in that corset, and yet he can be so nice. I do hope we find something. The worry must be awful. She noticed the bags and thin-etched lines around his eyes and the way his jowls hung down over his rumpled collar. A livid ivy of broken veins stretched over his cheeks. He was breathing heavily from the effort of getting up and stood there stuffing his stomach back into his belt. It was hard to believe he was still only 24. I could sense the tension in her body. The air crackled with it in that old, old room that had known so many joys and so many tragedies and seen generations of Rawlinsons and Maynards come and go. The stuttering candle traced leering phantoms on the walls. It was almost as if old Sir Henry and that awful American woman were still there. Yes, you could see them. Mrs. Radcliffe, still at table, straight-backed and cadaverous, poised over her sherry like a mantis, and bucolic old Sir Henry toying with a brandy, legs well apart in front of the fireplace, expounding his interminable exploits in front of the blaze. I could see the rascal's eyes gleaming like coals. Then he was coming at me through the undergrowth, big as a tank, with a pair of tusks on him, sharp as sickles. You've probably seen him in the study. I use him for defacing Reader's Digest these days. Well, rifle jammed, useless. Bearers, run off into the bush. Not that I blame him. What we'd seen back in the clearing was enough to turn any man's liver. Then he went on me, snapping and stabbing at my legs. I sidestepped neat as a blasted pansy and let go of the blighter with my fist. Biff wallop. They were walking towards a part of the hall I knew to be unsafe. It was no good. I had to warn them whatever the cost. Watch out for that loose floorboard, I shouted, then wished I hadn't. They both turned to glare at me. The rotten wood gave way, and frozen, they disappeared into the cellar. I stepped from my hiding place and, dropping to my haunches, peered into the hole. Maureen was head first in a barrel of dill pickles, struggling furiously. I knew she carried a snorkel in her handbag, but would she use it? Aubrey was unconscious, sprawled in the smashed floorboards. He looked pathetic and ridiculous. His kilt had come off during the fall. With his eyes closed, he looked as he had at Ponte al Mare that fateful summer. Older somehow, but that proud Ferguson chin was unmistakable. And the cheekbones, a little higher than his mother's, they appeared like twin humps on the top of his head. The terrible memories started flooding back. Old Mrs. McAvoy eating the horrible chicken and the terrified child running from the burning factory. He was starting to wake up. I had waited 4 years, flown 9,000 miles and crossed a seal with a Shetland pony to get away from this man. I remembered a tip of Dad's. The old boy had a thing about wasps and always wore bicycle clips when mowing the lawn. This seemed to keep a lot of them out. I snapped out of my reverie. Now for some answers. I hadn't planned it like this, but his eyes flickered. A shudder corrugated his face and lost itself in the corners of his mouth. His lips turned up at the edges and waited patiently in the deep shadows beneath the nose. Oh, well, now I was going to face the music.
Next week, Maureen is electrocuted to play Repertory in Nottingham, only to die of anonymity and scrapbook poisoning some 2 years later. Also, Rodney eats a worm. But, tiens, already I say too much.